This is with regard to the question that our brother had asked earlier regarding the image and form of God, image and form of Allah, and where is Allah exactly? So, brother Yusuf, you had answered the earlier part of the question, what is the image and form of Allah? But you had not answered the second part of the question, which was, where is Allah? So the sisters would like to be have that clarified.
The brother is here, we'll clarify it with him. Is the sister right? You wanted a clarification on that? Yes.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wassalam, rasulullah. This question, you say, where is Allah? I want to caution the Muslims on this subject for a reason. Because there is a small group of brothers scattered around the world and sisters who seem to think that if this question is asked and you don't get the right answer back, that quickly you can declare certain Muslims to be disbelievers. Okay, so I want to, before I give the answer, before I even talk about it, I want to say, please, let's don't do that. Because this is not the idea. We're not here to give a dipstick check to see how is your belief. Well, I'm going to run a rod down there and say, oh, you're about a quart low. I don't want to do that. But the reason to ask the question is really to ascertain, do we consider that Allah even exists? And if He does, where? Is it a physical existence? If so, how do I understand it? Islam has provided the answer very, very clear. Unfortunately, not all the Muslims have taken the time to read, study, and spend time with their scholars. Okay, if they had, then they wouldn't have to ask the question. But it is a legitimate question, and it was asked by the Prophet, peace be upon him, about a woman to determine, does she have the right belief in God? He said, where is God? And she pointed up like that. And that was sufficient. He said, this is a believer, you can get married to her, or whatever the situation was. The point is that this was a legitimate question and this was a legitimate answer. But now, I found from some other Muslims, so-called anyway, they're called the Nation of Islam, they asked me, after one of our programs, they said, well, if you said Allah is up, and you held your finger like this, okay, 12 hours later, the earth will rotate, so you'll be pointing the other way. Does that mean God went down, or how does that work? Huh? And right away you're going, oh. I don't think, and I'm talking about from the Hindus, the Christians, Muslims, everybody, I don't think anybody really considers that a legitimate question. That's kind of stupid. Because what you're saying is God is up above the heavens, wherever that is. God is not here, up there. So let us look to the Quran and see if we get some resolution for this. And Allah tells us in the Quran that He doesn't compare to anything in the creation. So if He was in it, then He would be compared to it. Therefore, conclusion is, it's not the creation. And He tells us, Laysa kamithlihi shay'in. That means He's not like His creation. He's not like it. Isn't anything like Him. And He says, Walam yakulu kufuwan ahad. There isn't anything like Him. He is unique. And He uses the word ahad from the same derivative of the root, wahad, or one, meaning uniquely one that no two is going to come after it. So Allah is so unique that even though He tells us He has a face, He tells us He has hands, He talks about Himself, but we don't say it's going to be like my hand. Does He have knuckles? Does He have a fingerprint? What is that? What do you... Has it got a face? He got eyebrows? Yeah. Why do you want to do that? We want to play, okay? This is not something to play with. This is, you're talking about your Creator. If He says something in His book, okay, accept that. And if you don't understand it, go to your scholars and ask them. But please don't use this word, this phrase, where's God, in the hopes of making somebody out to not be Muslim anymore. Because they could say, and it happens all the time, people say God is everywhere. Now, when a Hindu says that, they mean one thing. But when a Muslim says it, they might mean something else. Because if a person, for instance, the indigenous religion in the United States, American Indians, they had a belief, a lot of them, that God was in the creation. But some of them didn't. Some said He was out of it. But for those who said He's in it, they said He's everywhere, permeating His universe. There is nowhere except that God is there. He is in everything. That is pantheism. This means that God is literally everywhere. But when a Muslim says it, they may not mean that. What they may mean is clearly that His hearing is everywhere. His sight is everywhere. His knowledge is everywhere. and His mercy is everywhere. His love, al-wadud, is everywhere. His forgiveness is everywhere. But we don't put God like a physical being in His creation. I think that's the best way to distinguish it. There isn't anything that's going to happen in His universe that He's not going to be aware of or that He doesn't know. But at the same time, we're not saying He's in it. Let me share with you this little thing in closing on this subject. Someone could come to you with an age-old question that dates back to the times of the Romans and Greeks and their philosophies. They used to ask the question, do you believe in God? Now, these are atheists asking believers. The believer says, yes, I do. Well, can God do anything? Yeah. Anything? Yeah. Is there anything God can't do? No. Okay. Can He die? Gotcha. Because if you say yes, oh man, your God died. Sorry. And they'll play with you. Can He lie? Well, no. I thought you said He could do anything. Can He cheat? No. I thought you said He could do anything. Now, when they get you on shaky ground, they come with the one that they want to pull on you, which says, now, let me ask you, you said your God can do anything. Forget all the other stuff. Just one question. Can He make a rock? Sure, He can make a rock. Can He make a big rock? Sure. Can He make a really big rock? Yeah. Can He make a rock so big that nothing can move it? Sure. Even He can't move it? Uh-oh. Let me get back. Let me ask the sheikh. What will you say? Because the concept that you're talking about and the concept that the atheist is talking about, he's just playing with you. He doesn't care. We don't say God is in His creation, though, and then we don't get into trouble. Why? Because can Allah make this rock so big that nothing can move it? Sure. Even He can't move it? Excuse me. You were referring to the creation. The rock is creation. So I answered you based on that. Allah can make a rock so big that nothing in the creation can ever move it. But Allah is not in the creation. And He doesn't move things like that. He told us in the Bible and He told us in the Quran the same thing. Whenever He wants anything done, He says what? Kun fayakun. Be and it is. That's how He works. He doesn't go get a lever and a fulcrum and then, let me move that rock. Why did I put that over there? It's too big. This is not how God operates. And when you compare God to the creation, then you have brought this whole concept down to something that people will easily destroy. And then all you have left is your faith in what? And then you're not sure anymore. You get doubt. And then you just have to run over by yourself and you can't share your message anymore. So this is why it's important to stay on this pure and pristine image of what we believe about the Almighty. He is not like His creation. He is not in His creation. Creation has a point of time that it was coming about, whereas He is eternal. He's never having a beginning nor an ending. And this is what the Bible teaches, and this is what the Quran teaches. So we shouldn't compare Him to the creation. So make this distinction, and it becomes a lot easier.